Hello. Good morning again, this time again. This is the AI and Music Starts Festival, second panel of the day. I think that now the shows outside are starting, like the music is going to start to sound. And I want to welcome you, all the people who are sitting here at the auditorium of the CCCB, which stands for Center for Contemporary Culture, Center of Barcelona. And now we are here to talk about what exciting music can be made using AI. That's why we have called this panel AI and Music Future Genres, and we are going to explore what can be made like more creatively and perhaps less technically, but again, even so, with artificial intelligence. And for that, we have like three artists and a scientist, and actually two scientists and two artists or three artists, I don't know. I have no idea. It's very complicated, and the first thing that I can do, and the best thing that I can do, is to introduce you to Libby Heaney, Nabihah Iqbal, Jan Saint Werner, and Marius Miron. Please applause. And first of all, I would like to introduce you to Libby Heaney, who is an artist, a quantum physicist. That's why I was telling that there are people who are 50% artists, 50% scientists. Has been working with machine learning for the past few years and in a very playful way, which is very nice. And now he collaborates with Nabihah Iqbal on the project, The Whole Earth Chanting, that you can enjoy at 6, if I'm not mistaken. So now I will let it to Libby to make like her presentation about hybrid voices.
So thanks, Antonia. It's really great to be here at CCCB. And great to be back at Sonar. I spoke a couple of years ago on a slightly different topic. So today I'll be talking a bit about the process behind the project with Nabihah, which you can see later in the theater stage. So hybrid voices. So in the my practice is kind of working with machine learning, but taking an approach that comes kind of from a conceptual art perspective. So I'll be talking a bit about how and why I generated or started producing this work, a little bit about the technology behind it, and also kind of why I think it's important socially and the context of the work. So for The Whole Earth Chanting, we used a WaveGAN model. So WaveGAN is, I didn't develop it myself, it's an existing model, but I was really, having worked with machine learning previously, visually and with language, I was really interested in this idea of the latent space, which I'm sure some of you know already, is the machine learning representation of its training data. And it's this really high multidimensional space. So in this case, it was a collection of sound samples based on our training data. So you can see the different colors there perhaps could represent different categories of training data. It's unsupervised learning. So for us, I think each dot here was about a 2-second sound clip that was machine generated. And I managed to get the sample rate of 44 kilohertz, if that's interesting. I bring that up because it was quite difficult to go from like 16 kilohertz up to like really good quality sound. So for our project, we were interested in human and non-human chanting to kind of, well, I'll explore more about the concept towards the end. So to build the training data set before the lockdowns, luckily at the end of 2019, I went around in the UK to various spaces recording sounds that were non-human and human chanting. So on the left is a picture of me in the quantum physics lab at Imperial College in London. And I was taking, putting contact mics on all the different equipment there, electrical pickups, particularly because they have like spectrographic signals that look very, very similar to human chanting, but on different timescales. And it sounds amazing. You'll hear some of them in our performance later. Like kind of almost like a minimal techno beat when the machine learning generates the output clips. I'm also really I'm a football fan and I support a really terrible team in the UK called West Bromwich Albion. Back then, I think we were in the Premier League, but now we're not. But so I was working with the club. It was really, really nice. I had the microphone that, I forget the name of it, but it picks up sounds from all directions, and they allowed me to like record sounds from different points in the stadium, so behind all the like really crazy chanting fans, and up the top of the gantries behind the big TV screens. So I was working with the club for a couple of matches then. So then I created like these different training data sets. I think there was about a gig of wave clips for each different category. There was about 5 or 6 different categories. And you'll hear some of the output shortly. And in the latent space, I'm really interested that very similar sounds are close together in the latent space. So perhaps as humans, we wouldn't order or put these sounds next to each other. Our ears perhaps wouldn't be able to pick up the statistical similarity, but the AI can and does. And that for me was interesting, and I wanted to explore that before I approached the project. So in terms of voice, within each category of sound, so we had birds, for instance, as well. Because I was recording the training data, there's multiple different voices within each category. So there's not just one human football fan chanting, although I'm sure one or two were the loudest, but rather all the different individual voices are averaged over. So you kind of get this hybrid voice that's representative of that sort of idea, as opposed to these individual voices, which can be associated with an individual human body or a non-human body. And that, for me, conceptually is quite nice. So what I was really interested in doing was moving through the latent space. And so I was generating these clips that were about 2 minutes long. And they are built up of many, many of these two-second short samples. And you gradually morph between categories. And when you do that, you get these sort of hybrid voices where it's not one or the other, but kind of both at the same time. And that's something new. And that, I think that for me is really exciting. And you also get like machine artifacts as well, which again are unusual. But I think that for me is like, I'm not trying to copy reality. It doesn't interest me at all. I'm trying to produce something that's fuzzy and blurry and in between. So let's listen to one of the sound clips. I'm not sure how to get that to play. Can anyone help me on the...
Maybe someone can click on the...
Yeah. Thank you. So this is all machine generated. And it's gradually moving through the latent space. So that was one of the journeys through the latent space. There are probably almost an infinite number that you could generate. It's quite interesting because when you work with this wave gun, it takes ages to train, or at least on my computer, it takes ages to train. But then once you have it trained, you can output the sounds immediately. There's no sort of lag, or at least no perceptible lag, and you can generate like a huge number. So for me, that's really interesting as well. So going back to kind of the ideas behind our work, as a conceptual artist, a visual artist, I'm really interested in this idea of a non-human or a post-human. There's this wonderful book called Post-Human Spiritualities and Contemporary Performance. And this is a quote from it that kind of was part of the inspiration for the work. It says, the breach of ordinary perception as the encounter with the noumen presence, the holy other, an object whose nature, transcending the known, breaks the boundaries of the conceivable and provokes in the individual or collective encountering it unique types of emotion. I think that's what we're really trying to do with our performance, Nabihah and I. I'm really interested in sonic contexts that seem to invite the audience to inhabit and to explore the imaginary, the other, the unknown and the unexpected, and really enabling the other to enter and transform the audience. So I like to use machine learning to generate new sounds that transcend the boundaries of fixed categories. You could hear in the one we just listened to how there's hints of human voice, but also lots of machine artifacts. And you never kind of hear this individual clear voice. It's kind of this muted collective voice. As I said, I'm not really interested in copying the existing, as that won't lead us to new spaces of collective identity and belonging. Music and immersive performance with AI can create liminal spaces between discovery, experience, creativity, and imagination. The point of this is in part to reveal the performativity and the presence of entities in the world that are usually invisible and intangible, or suggest their presence. So, for instance, recording the rumbles of the equipment in the quantum computing lab. I'm interested in working with Nabihah to create music that entangles us with different social groups, which I think is important as a lot of polarization from this technology, from social media. You know, AI is deployed across the internet and often leads to kind of segregation and alienation in certain spaces. And I'm interested in music that helps to give priority to voices from the natural world as well. And these voices have typically been neglected from the archive. Historically, archives have always centered for human. And this is really important, of course, to connect us with nature in the face of a climate crisis. Big aims, but it's good to play around with these things. So I see this work, our work, as in some sense countering the notion of bias in AI. In other projects, I've done a lot of work on bias in AI because it kind of brings people together, not only in the performance, but sort of gets rid of the notions of categorization altogether into these kind of blurry hybrid spaces. So how can we use, in terms of future forms, there's so much I think musicians and artists can do with latent space representations, as these are really unique to AI. So how can they use that to move away from binary or copying the existing? I'm not interested in, or I've created this sort of very specific, you know, I've copied my voice. I'm not really that bothered about that personally. How can we use the latent space as an instrument live as well? That's something we're working on in a future commission. So that the agency of the AI, and I'm not talking about AI being conscious, I just mean like it has certain affordances. How can those affordances affect the performance in situ and really leading to an even further embrace of the uncertainty and unknown? Thanks.
Thank you very much. Let's say hello now to Nabihah Iqbal. She's a musician and a DJ, and she runs several radio shows. And she is also an historian and ethnomusicologist. And I think that it's very nice also to have in this arts and science meeting, as is this festival, like the perspective of someone who comes from humanities, which is like very necessary because it's also science. So, Nabihah, I leave it up to you for your presentation.
Thanks.
Welcome.
Thanks, Antonia, and thanks to everyone who's here. And it was great to start with Libby's talk because I think it follows basically the process of our whole project as well. And I want to start, before I get into talking about it, by showing a video, a very short snippet of the debut performance that we did of this project, The Whole Earth Chanting, a few months ago in England. So hopefully we can, it will come up. I just wanted to show that at the beginning, just to give you all an idea of the project that we've been working on and the different sounds. So Libby and I have been working on this together, and obviously Libby was taking care of the scientific side of it, as she spoke about, and creating the machine learning model to create all those AI clips. And we actually started working on this project because in London, our studios are next door to each other. And I didn't know Libby before that. And I would always look into her space and be like, what is she doing? And then we just started talking and then got this idea. So Libby came up with the concept of creating this kind of like audio-based project around AI sound. And then she knew that I was a musician, so asked if I would work on this with her. And obviously, I was really interested in it. And once Libby had made all the different field recordings of the different sounds and then fed them into the computer to create the AI samples, she then passed on those raw AI samples to me. And we spoke a little bit about what our ideas were to create the piece, you know. And then I was basically kind of like left up to my own devices to interpret those AI sounds and come up with an idea for the whole piece. And we looked at sounds from a few different areas. So one of them was birdsong, one was football chanting, as you saw earlier. There was also religious chanting, like Hindu chanting, and then Gregorian monks chanting, and then the sound of the machinery in the quantum labs at Imperial College in London. And I don't know if you noticed, but even in the video and also the raw AI clip that Libby played at, a bit earlier, you can hear that's, you know, completely untouched, just what the computer's produced. And the sub-bass frequencies in it are so prominent. And the first time we both sat down and listened to those raw AI samples, that's the thing that really struck us a lot, because I hadn't done any EQ manipulation, nothing. We just played it out of the speakers. And that day we were actually in like a big music studio with huge PMC speakers in the walls, so we really felt it. And then just thinking about that more, we thought, okay, well, these sub-bass frequencies are so strong, and that's quite an important factor in a lot of different types of music, especially, you know, dub and reggae music and that whole culture, which is based out of bass frequencies and transmitting them from the speakers and the music into the listener's body, right, through a huge dub system. So that was quite an important factor, and it's why we decided to work with a dub system based in the UK, in the Midlands, called Resonant Sounds. You might have noticed some of the footage in that video, because I really wanted to accentuate that type of the music. And so aside from thinking about it, you know, sonically, conceptually, this idea of the whole earth chanting and using field recordings and AI-generated sound. And then I had the idea that, okay, I wanted to blend all of those in with my own voice and instrumentation, because it kind of acts as a metaphor, I guess, for our society that we live in today, right? Like, all of those boundaries are being blurred between what's real and what's not real. And I was really taken aback by those AI sounds. I don't really know what to call them, because they sound like a human voice. They sound like birdsong, but there's no recording in it at all. And that was like quite a new experience for me, you know, to hear sound that sound like a human voice, but it's not. What do we call that? It's like fake sound, but it's not fake sound. I don't know. I'm just still trying to get to grips with that. So this whole idea of, you know, like the boundaries between humans and machines and nature, and I just think in our everyday lives, they're already kind of blurring on top of one another. And Libby and I spoke a lot about this idea of when most people talk about AI and technology, it's done in kind of like a way where we see it as often being quite a sinister force. You know, a lot of the news stories about artificial intelligence, they're talking about the more sort of like negative, invasive aspects of it. And what we wanted to do is flip that and look at the beauty that it could create. Because really, in those raw AI sounds, they are beautiful, and it feels, for me as a musician, it felt very moving to listen to them and to hear the beginnings of this new kind of sound technology and what it creates and how it makes us feel. And that's something that I wanted to develop within the show and the piece. So in the end, I came up with a 45-minute composition, and we wanted it to have like a transcendental, meditative feel, because I hope you'll agree that, you know, music is the most spiritual art form, and, you know, it gives us emotions that we don't get from anything else, and it makes us feel very deeply. And that's also one of the reasons why we decided to do the first performance of it inside a church, because we wanted it to be in a spiritual setting. We wanted to have that dub sound system there to emit those like huge bass frequencies and let them get inside all of the listeners' bodies. At that time, it was still like semi-lockdown, so everyone was sitting down and it was socially distanced, but they felt the music. And then Libby worked on the visuals and the lighting and the smoke to just create, you know, enhance more of that ambience. And so I didn't want the whole 45-minute piece to be like one linear journey. I wanted it to have like peaks and troughs, you know. So if any of you are coming to the performance tonight at 6 p.m, hopefully you'll get to experience it. But it fluctuates between these moments of like sort of like euphoria, like very calm, very beautiful, and then suddenly it might get into like a really abrasive section where you just feel like you're being assaulted by the sound. And then suddenly it might fall away again. So it's like, it's supposed to be a journey and open to interpretation. And it was really interesting to speak to people at the end of the the piece to like see what their reactions were to it. So if you come tonight, then it'll be good to like see what your feedback is as well. But it's just this whole idea of exploring a new way of working, a new sound palette. I actually personally don't think that AI will ever replace like human creativity when it comes to art, because you know, creativity is what makes us human. So I don't think we'll get to a stage where, you know, we'll have AI that creates like the perfect music and it will bypass all human creativity. Because I think if that was going to happen, maybe it would have happened already. Rather, I think it's just like another tool to work with. It could help us in certain ways and help us to explore new sounds. And maybe this is the beginning of a whole new genre. You know, it's like when synthesizers or drum machines were first invented and like people started using it like within their music. So that's how I feel. That's the kind of stage that I feel like we're at right now. And it'll be really interesting to see where it goes. And I really hope you can make it to the performance tonight. Thanks.
Thank you. And now let's say hello to Jan St. Werner. He is like the 50% of the band Mouse of Mars that you possibly know, because they have been like 27 or 28 years like making very forward-thinking music, like looking always to the future and looking always to what's next and bringing it to a very special musical discourse. And for their latest album called AAI, they built a speech synthesizer. Is that right? Yes? So Jan is going to tell us all about it.
Okay. Hello. So, thank you for your talks. This is inspiring. And actually, I'm taking the torch of this challenge and the idea that AI is something that we learn from, and we also learn about ourselves as humans. And what we should and can learn is also a different sort of empathy, maybe responsibility towards our environment and our own possibilities, like as humans, building technologies, building tools, but not letting them go and do some remote, maybe useful, maybe horrible work, but stay attached to them and build environments that we can still be part of. So this idea that humans are, machines are an extension of the human mind, the human feeling, the human technical capacity, that is what we wanted to approach with our idea of AAI, anarchic artificial intelligence. And the idea came when we spoke to a few friends of ours about these new technologies arising and how certain ideas of like who you want to be as a human being, who you are culturally, and you don't even have a choice, having a dialect, having a language that is not represented, that Siri cannot understand, that is really kind of your own, and it's a treasure, but it's not represented in this new algorithmic idea of like collecting data and then learning from this data and building new services. These people are out of these services. So we thought we should build an AI that actually does deliberately that it creates empathy. It looks for these in-between sounds. It looks for dialects. It looks for idiosyncrasies, for onomatopoesis, like sound that is just words, language that is just sound that's based on pure expression. A lot of this was kind of invented on, I mean, I think it dates further back, but it had a peak in the 20th century, early 20th century, in Dada, in Futurism, in Lettrism, in Fluxus, lots of different art forms developed this idea of like language could be pure expression. So we thought maybe we could combine this and create an AI that would have this idea, like it would connect with other AIs, maybe even like confuse them sometimes. Show them a different way of not optimizing and not improving continuously, but sometimes getting wild, sometimes maybe stopping and having a break. And then also articulation as an immediate form of expression, something that we as humans should also embrace and maybe even learn a bit more. Sometimes it would be nice if we would just talk in sound. Maybe what you do when you're in a club and you don't understand each other, you shout at each other, but And you don't even use words. It's kind of a different form of affection, or sometimes you just whisper, and maybe just the sound of a voice that's appealing. So all these factors went into developing this idea of a speech synthesis program that we've developed with two programmers, Rani Kedo, Derek Tingle, and then later with the company Birds on Mars, which ironically is called similar to my band's name. Pure accident, our friend Moritz Simon Geist, inventor of robotic machines, introduced us to Birds on Mars. And they had already built an AI for a painter, so-called Muse, an AI that would continuously repeat the same image, the same scenery of a driveway somewhere in LA, but depicted always anew, and then the painter would be inspired from that and also paint the same painting over and over again, but in so many different variations in color, expression. And so that was their big, like, that really kind of got them into working with artists, and they were like, so, I don't know, correct me if I'm wrong, 20% of their work capacity goes into supporting our project. And they were like, this, we haven't worked with sound yet, and we would love to work with you on this. So with Birds on Mars' help, we could develop this speech synthesizer, basically, which now exists as a web browser. And each time we want to play with our speech synthesizer, we go online, and there's a dedicated server in Birds on Mars' office. And with this, we can generate all kinds of absurd voices. To go back to the Mouse on Mars project, we collaborated with a researcher, poet, and scholar from Boston, Louis Chudesoki, who, based on the talks we had and the stories we exchanged, wrote a narrative that is the basis for AAI, the album. And the story is also being told in the album, really deliberately with a voice. So we thought our AI should have Louis's voice. If he agrees, we train the AI on him. So he has written the story, he's telling the story, but again, it's a metaphor on a human telling that story, being told by a machine that has been programmed by humans. So he agreed on that, and we took some time to train the speech synthesizer on him. So I'm playing you a little sample of Louis talking without any processing.
And furiously, immediately became unsustainable. Artificial intelligence, was defined by its capacity for growth, authentic intelligence began to lose its the sense of superiority of all human beings.
So you see, it's kind of a bit rushed and a bit hard to understand. What we did is we chopped up the bits that were good to understand and put them in the record. So if I make him say that again, the server will, the AI will recalculate. It will sound different, so let's try this, the same text processed again.
The fear of machines is rooted in the idea that the artificial was secondary, inferior.
So inferior, he has a problem saying inferior. I say he immediately. It's an AI. It's something. It's a world. So this is like the legible part of it. But then we have some parameters similar to like what you just said, a very early synthesizer. We wanted like to go into the voice and perform like the features of the voice from inside. So we added the feature, which is new language. It will chitter the syllables. I'm adding a bit of new language to the text now, and then a parameter which is called sing. But sing is not it's not applying melody in a traditional sense. It's not like trying to make the voice sing pentatonically. It's just emphasizing certain features of the vowels and bring them out a bit more. I make Louis talk a little slower, and I'm going to reprocess this. Waiting for server response.
The fear of machines was rooted in the idea that the artificial was secondary, and for that it became unsustainable. Artificial intelligence was defined by its capacity for growth. Authentic intelligence began to lose its sense of superiority. All human beings had left was the power of their prejudices.
So So this kind of stuttering and this weird glitch is something that's actually, I think, something that Libby also explored with her project. And it's very charming in a way because a new language arises, and of course you immediately want to zoom into that. So we used a lot of these parts and created harmonies from that. And the whole record AAI is based on the kind of, let's say, core harmonics of Lewis's voice or this artificial voice. And I'll give it a bit more tweak now. I really crank up the parameters. I crank up the speed and a bit the pitch. I make him sing more, and then I recalculate, waiting for server response. So now internet is not ready for AI. So similar to Libby's project, this is using latent space and does basically vector hacking. So there is a big amount of randomness. What we want to do next is like find out which features in the voice make a voice have persona. So sounds, guttural sounds, sounds in the lower region of the throat, tongue movements, size of your mouth, lip movements. I mean, there's a lot of parameters. It's like a huge world. So we want to get closer to this. What we have here is really a very first suggestion. And still, the variations are quite strong. We created a second Lewis voice, and these parameters are even a bit more crazy. Let's recalculate this. Okay, I think I overdid it a bit. There's not really any talking anymore, but it's quite a good chant. Maybe I can download this sample, maybe for the performance.
Just do it.
I think so.
Yeah, sneaking into your performance. Then we created an electronic version of Lewis, which is basically trained on electronic sounds, but trying to apply features of Lewis's voice that we could detect on a very basic level. So this is Lewis talking as an electronic sound, and the electronic persona is trained on sounds Andy and me made and feed the AI with. Quite short, but you get a hint. There's still some Lewis in there. It's quite striking that we're so sensitive to these features. Everything that has a human appeal, it kind of stands out immediately and jumps at us. Two things I'd like to mention. I really like this kind of waiting for server response because it reminds me of the very early days of electronic music where people had to calculate sounds with supercomputers, send a floppy disk through the whole city of, let's say, Paris, wait for a day, and then get like a second or even half a second of sound back of like a vase or like a bottle cracking. And then the computer would, like, based on certain features, make an electronic version of this. And then they would slide in the floppy disk, and like 10 representatives of the Groupe Recherche Musicale would kind of like listen to what the computer has done. So in a way, I like this. Each time I see waiting for server response, I feel like I'm back in the 60s or something. I think that's it. Maybe one last thing. We created a speed version of Lewis so we can kind of jitter through the voice a little bit more with like stuttering back, like faster and slower calculations. Let's see what that does. Back in the 60s. Okay, thank you.
I was thinking that maybe we could read like a short excerpt of Louis' text that has made for your project. Just short, so I will read it myself so that you feel intrigued, and when you go home, like, you look for it and read it all full.
Yeah, there is. We created a website which is called anarchic.ai, and we were very excited that no one had reserved that domain yet, so we immediately bought it. And what you can see is a generative video by Casey Rees, who provided visuals for AAI, a programmer from Los Angeles who also runs the platform Ferrofile that Libby and me just recently released music on, purely digital art. In your case, it wasn't music, right, Libby?
Yeah,
this was visual. So Casey created this video for us, and each time you open the Anarchic AI browser, this video is being created from scratch. It's actually a browser-based video. And then you have a few buttons, so you can download Lewis's text, you can download a game, which is based on AI. It's a video game, which we will also play live during our performance tonight. So we found somebody at Sonar who's willing to like play the game while we play the concert. And so it's kind of a parallel performance. The game was programmed by David Jörgmeier and, Jörg Andreas Meisser and David Meyer, whatever, two very friendly friends of ours who spent weeks on programming this game. And you can download the game and kind of cruise through an AAI world, also with sounds from us. So that's another deconstruction of this whole AI idea. And a few other little things, links to CTM Festival, who supported the project. So Anarchic AI is also where you can find the text that Antonia is reading an excerpt from.
Yeah. Now imagine Louis' voice, which you are already familiar with, instead of hearing my voice. Just a short thing.
Yeah, your brain is a latent space too, by the way. And that's and that is the beautiful metaphor about like of the latent space.
So it's called Creolization and Machine Synthesis, Mouse on Mars and AAI by Louis Schudes. Okay. History has taught us that humans can be made inhuman, transformed into animals or treated like objects. Laws and social practices have been enacted for specifically these purposes. Because technology has been implicated in this history, we wanted to imagine and make possible the opposite. We wanted to craft a story in which inhuman objects could redefine life and reimagine what it is to be human. To do this, we rejected the age and tired cliché of robot rebellion or machine takeover that has guided science fiction for so much of its history. Stories of machines as slaves to human beings that go from compliant to resentful and rebellious inevitably return when new technological developments erase the memory of previous ones. They generate even greater anxiety when a fear of others is recast in technological terms. So, did you hear Louis' voice? I think so. Mm-hmm. Anyway, you can go to AAI website and read the whole text. And let's go for the last presentation before we go into conversation in Q&A. And let's say hello to Marius Miron. He is a senior researcher at the Music Technology Group at Pompeu Fabra University. He is our full scientist for today. And he works on several topics at the intersection of music technology and AI. And he also has like a very interesting perspective because he also works with fairness in AI. So Marius, it's all yours.
Yeah, so maybe we can put the presentation if possible. Most of the people in my group, the music technology group at the UPF, are doing music in their after work somehow, and they use technology to inspire their music projects, and I think that's interesting. And some of them they have collaboration with other musicians. And it's interesting to see what it can come out of that. In my case, so I was, well, maybe, yeah, it's there. So, yeah, this is where I'm working, Music Technology Group. You can check our website. We have lots of cool projects, and if you want to collaborate with us, you can go there, mtg.upf.edu. And, yeah, this is a bit of my biography. I worked in several places. I've done some interfaces to control the groove in music and make DJ sets more groovier. I've been doing my PhD in source separation for orchestra. I worked a bit on fairness and criminal justice, and now I'm working on lots of topics. So anyway, I wanted to go back to 10 years ago. Where, so who remembers Sonar 10 years ago? It was held here. And it was really nice, and it's nice to party in the center of the Barcelona. And we had this event. So when I was doing my master's, and I never thought of being a scientist back then. I just wanted to do cool stuff with music. So I wanted to hack my way around music, to be creative. I was not thinking, I'm just an accidental scientist. So, and this is like all of the people participating at this hack day in Sonar. I think now this transformed in Sonar Innovation Challenge and so other more serious events, but back then you could just do like a hack with five or six people, and then you had 24 hours to work like crazy and use any kind of music technology and APIs provided by the companies. And people have seen really crazy hacks, like somehow control similar sounds to create loops that are connected, or use these shoes with sensors to teach people how to dance, or control the music, or beer can sampler. I think Robert Kay did that. So it had many crazy, wild ideas, and people were inspired by that. But somehow, back then, hacking music technology looked like this. So it looked like a piece of puzzle. That you put all of these things together, all of the technologies connected through some API, you use some bit detection, and then you created the hack. And of course, something broke. So you could see this blue screen effect in the presentation that these things were failing, because you had to connect so many pieces together. And nowadays, there are hacking events happening nowadays, and it looks like this. So you don't see so many pieces together. It's basically machine learning model. People actually train one model for a hack day, and then this model does this particular task, and it does it well. So, and actually what people think when you tell them that, okay, I use AI to do this, they think of this. So somehow they think of like this robot or persona that knows something about music, and this leads somehow to the idea of artificial general intelligence. But I think it's not really the case. This is basically a far-fetched dream for our hackers community. And what we do learn is like models. We learn models of reality. It's like a Camp Nou Lego model. And how that would you learn that? No, you basically look at many photos of Camp Nou. Depending on the quality of the photos and the angles, you could reconstruct this artificial model of reality. And that leads to the quality of the data. So it depends on the photos you have. You can end up with a different kind of model. And you should never forget, this is like a model of the reality. This doesn't represent the reality itself, but somehow you can still make sense for you and understand somehow the reality and play with it. So that leads us to a few key issues that I want to point out. So the reliance on training data. So this basically the training data that has biases. So it's defined by some characteristics. There is no neutral training data. It was created by humans. Humans also have biases. And you must be aware when you work with the data, with sounds, even like how is this data gathered? What was the purpose? Data quality. I mean, do you cover some sort of classes? You don't cover other classes, demographics in your data. In the voices, you can think of female, male voices or ages, or do you want some sort of fair representation on that? Also, licenses, is it okay from the ethics point of view to use some data that is public domain or, I don't know, some music and generate music similar to that? There are some ethical implications of using data. And also in music data as well, sound and music data. So, going back to our robot, so the technology that we use, it's agnostic to the nature of the problem. So the same model can be used for image classification, for self-driving cars, for music. I don't know if it doesn't really care the technology that and learn something about the music. I think it just learns some distribution of data, which is like totally agnostic to the nature of the thing that we want to learn. And the other thing is like that, yeah, we let's be fair, most of the systems are still black box. People are working towards interpretable models. But we trade off interpretability for accuracy. So you can think of this like 3D printing. So what you want, when you do 3D printing, you have a model which is in your computer. You do a 3D, you print this, and you have a perfectly, almost with no errors, shape. And when you do Lego, you understand somehow that things are connected. But and you can change things very easily by adding more Lego pieces. But the resolution of this, it's like rough, so it's not so perfect, let's say. It's not so specialized either. So leading to that, these models are more difficult to control, to retrain, to modify. I mean, you spend like hours training this on your computers, that makes you think like, okay, people are using lots of these pre-trained models to this, and this. What are the implications of this issue? The other thing is like, I'm saying this expensive, but actually I want to pair this with a bit of AI inequality, which like a fairness issue, the AI literacy. Like, we have here cases of artists that use AI, but some other artists that want to do that, maybe they are not educated into that or do not have the connections or the money to do that or the people to help them to express their ideas, and this might lead to further societal disparities. So, I want to just encourage all the musicians to get in touch with us, with scientists, with people working with music technology. I want to encourage companies to publish their model and be transparent with the data that they use and the models that they use. And we need people from all backgrounds, from all races, all countries, ages to use these models, all sorts of musicians, so we can explore what are the limitations. If we use people just from a certain background to create musical instruments, these instruments will be biased towards a certain category and towards a specific aesthetic style, and I think this somehow limits the creativity. So we need to encourage people to interact with technology, with machine learning model, and don't be like one last magic. So don't be scared of breaking things. So even if it's a machine learning model, it can be broken. And point that out, shout, and let people know that you've been using that model. So, yeah, that's my presentation.
Yeah. Thank you very much. I want to encourage the people who are watching us at home to bring their questions in. I can receive them via telepathy, and then we will ask them to our participants today, and we will answer. So please do so if you want. And I'm going to ask, actually, the technical team, because this is something that I have to ask, and they might say no. Can we have questions from the room? No. Okay. Oh. What you can do afterwards, they are busy because today they are all playing, but maybe you can chase them around the area so you can make them the questions
live. People can go online, no?
Yeah, you can also do that. Go to the festival's website and bring in your questions if you wish. I found something like super interesting listening to Libby, to Nabihah, and to Jan, that when working with such, I would say, cutting-edge technology as is artificial intelligence, you go back to things that are very essential, very, in a way, I cannot find the word right now, ancestral, like Jan with the voice, and you were talking about like the phonetic system, like the shape of the mouth and how the tongue moves inside, and things that are like very, very basic and very human. And Nabihah was also referring to this connection with the spirituality and with things that are like very, very ancestral and very ingrained in human nature. And Libby like looking also for these super, I would say, human things like chanting and the football supporters, because it's something like very, very primal. Like when you are cheering your football team, it's very primal. It comes very from within. So I am surprised like working with very cutting edge technology, but with very ancestral, very human, very, I don't know, organic, deep, basic, I don't know, material in a way. I don't know if you have any ideas about this. It's not a question, it's a reflection.
I think you've summed it up really well. And I haven't really thought deeply why we've all, you know, all three of us were talking about that. I guess it just comes down to like the essence of what you're trying to do, or the essence of art or creativity, because you want to, through music or through art or through whatever you're doing, even this like technological research, even with science, I guess one of the main aims is to connect with others, right? It's like a form of communication. And then that's probably why we've all like focused in on the human voice, because that is the most familiar sound to anybody since the beginning of time. And even though like the technology's changed and we're dealing with something new, you still want to go back to that. And that's definitely the reason why we wanted to do the first performance of our project inside a church as well, because we just wanted to emphasize that, like that very spiritual and very sort of like the essence of what we were trying to do in the space, and to see how that made people feel as well, and bringing like even the Dove sound system in there. Although when we did that, the people who worked in the church, we told them we were bringing our own speakers, and they were like, cool, yeah, that's fine. And then when we turned up with the truck like full of like these huge speaker stacks, they were like, oh. And then and then when this the guy, you know, during the sound check, it was really, really loud, because I think even like the guys who ran the sound system, you know, they hadn't played it for 2 years because of lockdown. And then like the people working in the church were like, it's going to make the windows break. They were really freaking out. Yeah, it was all the windows were shaking. But it's just like the idea of bringing all of those elements together to try and like enhance or emphasize or get deeper into that idea of like, how does this music make us feel? Like, how does the AI make us feel? And yeah, that's just going back to basics then.
Another thing that I was thinking right now is that you mentioned that in your work you used also like Gregorian chants and Tibetan chants, and there are quite a few music projects related to AI that look for these very ancient sources instead of looking into the future. It's like looking into the human history and human culture, like from the earliest days, just to make creative, forward-thinking works. And that kind of surprises me. Like,
I think it was creating like a ritual around the work. I think this idea of ritual is really important, and I think all of us, Jan and Nabihah and I, we're really trying to like subvert this predominant use of the technology, you know, all the big tech companies and so on are using this technology in quite nefarious ways, like people like Zuboff has written a book called Surveillance Capitalism, you know, and that is true as well, but let's see if we can, you know, that exists, but let's see how we can use these machines in ways that are more sort of positive to bring people together. And I think ritual and this sense of like going back to when people were kind of more connected with nature, perhaps, because of a sort of situation of how they lived, is one way to do that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I just had a chat with Andy this morning, and he was like, so what is the conference about again? And I was like, yeah, I don't know. But anyway, for artists, it doesn't really make such a difference. You can use it as a tool, and it's interesting. You can experiment and try things, but it's a monster, he said. AI is a monster in the hands of the big corporations who already own this, and not just big corporations generally, in the hands of humans who are not explorative or experimental, but see the benefit of more control, more efficient data retraction, and just predicting human behavior in the most horrible sense in many, many ways. I think we're hopelessly romantic on this stage, trying to subvert this, trying to bring in alternatives and suggesting that, hey, you could also see it that way. You could also do this. So I'm seeing some of the questions popping up on the screen.
There are questions. We'll make them. I have the telepathy connected now.
Yeah, so they're coming straight from your non-verbal latent space, yeah. Basically. And of course, AI and music, will AI make better music? It doesn't matter. If AI does better music, then it's better music for you. I mean, it depends on what you want in music or sound. I think Spotify is already an AI-driven idea of music, you know? It's an algorithmic idea of providing you with the best possible environment suited to your profile. And that you know some of this music from way back, what's the difference if it was new music or music you already know? What's happening is like you're being put in a very consistent environment that makes you ideally a perfectly happy consumer, because you don't have needs, you don't have, there's no lack of anything. What you need is immediately there. So there's many ways, and what we're doing here, I think, is trying to get into the core of what AI is, and we're still at the beginning. We're fishing in the dark. The latent space that we're trying to hack into is like, it's what Marius just said. It's very difficult to like say, if I want the voice to have a more accentuated appeal, or if I want it to sound more percussive, it's really hard to deliberately do this. So what you do is you create suggestions, mistakes all the time, and then suddenly something pops up that you say, oh, this does what I had in mind. So it's a long way to go until the AI really behaves in a musically perfect way, at least for the way we did it with Mouse and Mouse. And then the aspect of bias, I don't know how many of you know about this term. It's basically decisions that are presets that are being made unconsciously. It's the Marie Antoinette phenomenon of like a technological society that says, so why would we even bother about this? Because this is not of any concern. And so you program your stuff and you forget of like of the most basic and most important things to like 90% of the people who will be confronted with what you're creating. So bias are all these kind of subliminal decisions. You're not even aware of yourself and all these factors, you know, you have to bring them back onto the table and then see how you can play with them or how you can subvert them or how you can delete them or how you can draw attention towards them. But this is what we're doing, and I think we're really, I think we're hopelessly romantic. I think the game is probably already decided, right? So these questions, AI versus music, I don't know if I'm actually really thinking about this at this point.
Actually, there was one question from the audience that Marius kind of answered it during his talk, and you have just brought up the topic now. Is like, will AI make music like more uniform or more diverse? And I think that you responded like very, very well, like depending on on how the technology is made. So, and what I wonder, like, especially Marius, that you work at your university with a lot of people who create the technology to make music. I guess that the technologists, when creating the new tools, they get very excited and have many, many things in mind. But from the perspective of the musicians that can ask things to technology, actually, I think that technology, any technology, evolves because the artists ask things that this technology should do. What can artists, creators do to make this technology evolve or make notice the technologies and the developers know this is needed, we need these tools, we need these tools to make this or that. Can we do it that? Or we can just accept, I don't know.
I think the companies try to involve musicians in the way that they design instruments, but maybe this is not, it's very less, so it's some sort of biased. So we actually, what we want to do is to listen to artists' perspective. So in the same way we do evaluations in music recommender systems that we care about, we measure how happy are the users with the music we provide them. In the same way, we should like get involved musicians to evaluate our technology give us feedback. I think this maybe doesn't happen so much at the moment. So people are guided by their own creativity. And I think in that way we just provide tools. We don't provide aesthetic solutions. So it's up to you, the musicians, to do anything with those tools and explore them as you may wish. So
I have a burning question that perhaps Marius knows about them, maybe you too, or it's like, should AI creations be covered by copyright law? If so, how?
Yeah, I co-authored an article on that topic. It's like still a gray area in the European law as well. So we don't know at this moment. We have there was no like people going on court with any machine learning model that was trained on some data that was copyrighted, and someone claiming copyright issues on the machine learning model. There is no issue on that. But you may think if someone uses a composition, so I'm not referring to the audio, but the composition itself, the score, let's say, and generates another score based on a corpus that was copyrighted, that they may claim some sort of copyright, some rights on that, the works produced by the machine learning model. And this has like huge implications. Like you can generate, there is this research done by Bob Sturm, who leads a European project on this. So basically he got into this Irish folk music community, and he got lots of scores from there, and he trained a machine learning model that could reproduce 50,000, 30,000, 1 million of Irish folk music works in the same style. Does that devaluate the value of that music? How does that impact the small community? So there are questions which are unanswered, and I think the community struggles now to think of this thing, and I think it's good that we bring them to the discussion. But yeah, it's a gray area in conclusion. We don't know what are the legal implications, because as a society, we haven't decided yet if this is ethical or not, or what we should as a community to act and use this models.
Mm-hmm. We have another question. It's I guess that maybe it's for Libby, but feel free, any one of you, to answer. If AI will never replace human creativity, does AI have any room to be or become creative? Because when you were talking your travels in the latent space, I thought that the creative one was being the artist, not the machine. So what would you say?
I mean, I tend to avoid the discussions around creativity and think more in terms of agency. But I don't take agency to be related to consciousness. I take a definition of agency from like Karen Barad, which she writes, agency is the ability to act. So how, in terms of, I interact with the AI and I'm programming in different sets of vectors for the AI to kind of move between, perhaps in more of a linear sense or with some curvature in the latent space, depending on what I'm trying to, like, it's hard to interpret the latent space because it's so high dimensional, as we've heard. So you, and but from both of the guys over there, but you kind of, as you play around with it, you kind of get a sense of it. So you're like, okay, the number 34 here in the vector gives me this type of thing. So I'm kind of controlling parts of the journey from my intuition of it. But then the AI, I always think, has its own agency as well. So in terms of, it has an ability to act on what it produces as well. So the machine artifacts, kind of how it has arranged the sound samples so that the statistically similar ones are closest. And it's picked up on patterns that as humans, you know, we probably couldn't even perceive. But it said, oh, that's close, that sound clip is close to that sound clip, so I'm going to put it next to it in the latent space. So that is its own agency. Whether that is creative or not, because I see like AI just as a very, very complicated statistics. You know, so it's kind of this co-creation, I suppose. But that's how I would see it. I hope that makes sense. Yeah.
It makes total sense. I don't know if you have any other ideas about this question. Yes.
I actually wanted to ask you something. So would have been much easier for you to do music with the WaveGAN if someone created an architecture, a variant of WaveGAN, let's say, that was had the latent space with the variables that you could have more control on, rather than you exploring various things and...
Yeah, absolutely. So, I mean, I've been working with... this project kind of came out... It started as like a passion project, so it had no funding. So I was like really working with the AI myself rather than developing it into something else, taking it further. But the next steps where we're working on our next commission together, we're taking this further into something that's more tunable, yeah, and with more sort of explainability, yeah.
That's nice.
Jan had something to say.
I mean, the question is always how you define creativity. If you're making a techno track and you're using a 909 bass drum and you keep it straight on the one, that is not super creative. You could put it out on a record and it's your track. I mean, maybe add an open hi-hat and a sample of your grandmother shouting. It would be a great techno track, but how much of that is really a massive effort of creativity? It is really the context in which you place these things, and it's the definition of authorship. And I think also how far you want to push it. I mean, there's always preset. In every synthesizer you have presets. Every Fender guitar and Fender amp have distinct sounds. And then the way you play these things make that become interesting music. So I think an AI is in that sense a tool. And of course, we have to define, like, is there authorship involved? Who owns the AI? Who's responsible? And it's interesting that in the creative field, these questions come up. But if you use your Instagram account, and with every picture you look at, and the lengths of how long you look at it, and in which context you click on the next picture, that all that stuff creates, and that AI is being trained on you at that very moment. You feed data into an AI, and no one's asking if that is ethically okay or not. We're using this stuff on a daily basis, and that's just an example. I think we should profoundly think about our relationship with AI in terms of, like, who owns the data that an AI is actually retrieving. And I think that is also something you work on.
Yeah, I wanted to say something else because I found it very interesting in all the three presentations that there is some term called uncanny valley. Are you familiar? Is the audience familiar with that? So in robots, there is like a beginning where things are like look funny and stupid and like they don't really look like human, and they start getting better, and they, at some point they reach like complete humanness, and there is something called uncanny valley, which is like a place where starts to get human, but it's quite not. So it produces the kind of like these weird artifacts, which could be interesting and created and explore somehow the limits of AI. And I think at some point it can be interesting to explore the artifacts of AI. And it can be like the errors of AI can also be a creative ground that you can play on. So I found it really interesting. I was not familiar with it. I was seeing it. I found it really interesting in all the three presentations.
I would like to hear also Nabihah's ideas, because for you, the AI-generated soundscapes allowed you to be more creative. And in your presentation, you were outlining all the exciting things that can be done. So what do you feel about?
So it's interesting, you know, hearing, like receiving that question and then also hearing what everyone else has had to say. And for me, I'm coming at it purely from the perspective of an artist and a musician and not the science. And thinking, you know, that question about, well, does AI have room to be creative and, you know, to take over? It's just, when I was approaching this whole project, it was just thinking about like the emotional response, really. What are you trying to create? What feeling are you trying to create? Or what kind of thoughts are you trying to provoke in the listener? Which I think every artist and every musician approaches their work with. And we've got like one side of AI and algorithms, like, you know, that's already been explained on Instagram or other social media online, which is just basically collecting data and then figuring out what you want and presenting you with, I don't know, adverts for like socks because they know you've run out of socks or something. But that's like a totally different from using AI to create a sound and you don't really know what's going to come out. But when you receive whatever's come out of the machine learning, then you think like, okay, if I need to make this into a piece or if I'm going to use this in my work, what am I trying to do with it? And I think that's what maybe, that's the sort of chasm between, you know, just straight up machine learning and what happens when you pass it on to an artist or you try and present it in your own way. And that fear, you know, that approach with emotion at the forefront is probably the thing that like separates us, and I hope it will always separate us, but who knows what will happen.
Actually, emotion is something that we are going to talk about in the last panel today, I think is at 6, so you will have to choose either if you see Nabihah's and Libby's show or if you come here to listen to. We are going to explore the role of emotions and artificial intelligence and how humans perceive and how we can teach machines to perceive human emotions. So it's a big topic in AI. And we have one last question from the audience. Not sure if you have answers, but I think that you have reflections. Is if Spotify is AI, where do we draw a line between what is AI and what it's not nowadays? Actually, we've discussed this a little bit in the first panel. So if you look it up, you will find it. What do you think? What is AI? What is not AI? And I'm not sure if they are asking a technical question.
Don't use Spotify. That's what I'd say. And probably my label would just kill me for like saying that. But I just feel like with some, I don't know, it's true. I think Jan was saying it before, like everything's there, right? Everything's available and you kind of get sucked into it without knowing. And there's loads of pros to that. You know, like when you go down a YouTube rabbit hole, for example, and you start clicking on suggested videos of music that kind of are related to what you're listening to, and you discover loads of amazing things, and that's really cool. And I mean, the fact that like Spotify has created this platform where you can listen to everything is good in a way, but then there's a lot of cons. And as an artist, you know, you probably feel those more, and that's why personally, like, I don't really use it because, and I'm not. I mean, yeah, maybe there's something about like, you know, stuff being suggested to you so much that you kind of get sucked in, and then you don't actually, I think about this, but you don't know if you're choosing that or if it's just you're listening to, you know, it's like on Netflix when you just start, I don't have Netflix either, but when you just start watching all these things that are suggested to you. And that I find really daunting. So I much prefer, you know, listening, finding out about music in my own sort of natural, organic way, buying music if I like it, because that's actually supporting the art. And that's like a separate issue with regards to Spotify, but I think it's like the biggest, most important issue, to be honest. And yeah, just, I don't know, just like going with the flow and not being sucked too much into the technology world is, would be my recommendation.
That reminds me that I can make like an analogy with machine learning and supervised learning and unsupervised learning. Let's say that if you use these platforms to discover music, it's supervised learning. They present you with things, and otherwise you go out to the world and see what you find as you explain. This would be unsupervised learning in a way. So, Jan.
I know it sounds very conservative, but I would like to know which data of my behavior is being tracked. So if I use Spotify, I'd like to have a little field of statistics. We've retrieved these type of data from you, and we will do this with this data, which also comes back to the point like copyrights, authorship. If you create something with AI or any digital artwork, will you be able to track where it's going? So, but that again brings in another difficulty. Do you want everything trackable? Do you want that every data also of what you deliberately spread on the internet or wherever in the world, do you want it to be trackable or do you want things to go? That's great about a CD or a piece of vinyl. It just goes and you don't know where it ends up and somebody puts it on Discogs and you find it there eventually and you see, this could be the copy that I sold at some point, or this is definitely the copy because it has like this little scratch. These kind of things of the physical world, we have to think about how we bring those into the digital world. But again, what the AI part of Spotify is exactly this, like learning from data that you are giving and you're not conscious of that. And that is a difficult situation.
And that definitely happens, actually, I just want to say, because when I had a meeting at the Spotify office, the HQ in London, when my last record came out and they brought me in and they were like, okay, we've like put together this whole presentation just for you, catered like to your listeners. And it's crazy. And it just made me realize that it's basically like spying on you through your listening to music, because they had like such an in-depth breakdown of who was listening to my music, where, the gender, the age group, the time of day, just everything. And then basically they use all of that to like, I don't know, put you on a, you know, if they wanted, they'll put you on like a certain playlist that they know has loads of hits from those people, from that demographic, and it will just, you know, make your stream numbers go up even more, or they could do the opposite, things like that. And for me, like, you know, music is my life and it's my favorite thing in the whole world. And I was like, this is just, you know, like, it's just a heinous thing. And I didn't really like that fact, because everybody who listens to Spotify or uses it, they don't know that that's going on behind the scenes, or you'll never really think about it. And I'm not sure how it makes me feel, but it's kind of strange, yeah.
Yeah, it relates to the idea of power. So power over the artists and power over the individuals, listeners. The algorithms can act on individuals, you know, on a YouTube journey, a rabbit hole, or when we're listening to different songs on playlists, and it can really like learn to act under our awareness. So we're not aware we're being influenced. So this has like big questions around kind of, you know, how free are we when this is like we're being assaulted all the time by these sort of little nudges. They're subtle nudges. And there's been a lot written about this. Kate Crawford wrote a book called Atlas of AI, which is really good about AI and power. Not necessarily about Spotify, but it applies. These ideas apply across the board, I think. And it's just scary how much power these big corporations, and they're not democratic, I'm stating the obvious here, but, you know, they have so much power over individuals, listeners and artists, yeah.
I think we really have to be aware that AI is able, amongst a couple of other technologies, to create single individual worlds or realities, experiences. So and I think this is a big challenge or one of the big issues for artists. We want spaces that we can share with other people, and we don't want to know necessarily who these other people are. We want these spaces to be as open as possible. But what is already happening is that people live in different realities, and that feeds into the politics. Obviously, it's a big issue since, I mean, we know about all the consequences of like individualized data supply, and this is one of the biggest dangers, that we are being, worlds are created for us and they're so consistent. On your app, it like Google will know your favorite restaurants, your favorite places to go. So you explore a city just by based on your preferences. And you're not exploring anything. You try to find the same thing again and probably even improved. So it's even the better artisan coffee or the better, whatever, fashion designer shop in Barcelona than before. But you're not experiencing anything new. And same for music or all kinds of other things. So to stay out of that kind of consumer identity that you're very likely to already be and even stronger become, I think this is where we have to push forward and use AI and, I don't have a better word, but anarchify it somehow, really like break it up, understand how it works, create new things with it, make it absurd, make it useless, or even build cool tools with other people that open new spaces, non-exclusive spaces.
Yeah, I think that's what with our projects, we're really trying to push against against this sort of capitalistic appropriation of these tools. But it's very hard because obviously we live in this super neoliberal society.
I think what we don't want is kind of this Mad Max kind of society where we get these tools from the companies that are have not been created for what we want to use them and somehow hack them to use them for in our creative purposes or for our daily lives. And these tools are for, it's just impossible to train them, to modify them, to do anything to them. And this kind of puts you in this kind of post-apocalyptic scenario, and we don't want that. We want to be inclusive when we design these tools. And I think we should do some more work on that, on scientist and developer's side.
So we have reached the end of the panel because there are no more questions from the audience, and I think that we can wrap it up. And instead of finishing with this kind of somber note, let's cheer it up, because I think that, today you are going to be able to enjoy a Mouse on Mars show in the evening, and this afternoon Libby and Nabihah's show, so this is something to be excited about. And I'm also sure that we are going to hear lots of exciting music in the near future from these artists. And Marius' department at the university, they are going to possibly invent absolutely crazy tools that will enable artists to do amazing things. So please applaud them. Thank you, and thanks to all of you. Gracias a tots per l'atenció. Thank you very much.